This is the companion video to Tuning with Shock Angle, the math version. This is the intuition version with no math required. Ever hear someone say, stand your shock up or lay it down? What exactly does that do? And how does it change the performance? In this video, I'm going to show you very simply what all those chassis holes and shock mount options do and how you can easily remember how to tune without consulting a textbook. On this channel, we look at the science behind your grown-up toys. I've worked with dozens of world-class athletes and helped them win 49 World Cup and World Championships in 8 different cycling disciplines. One thing I've learned over 25 years experience is that when it comes to human-machine interaction, there are 2 approaches to understanding how they interact. One way is scientifically by the numbers, and the other one is intuitively by instinct and feel. Now, feelings and opinions can't change the underlying physics, but you don't have to pull out a calculator to make improvements to your equipment. You can approach shock tuning through trial and error and learn instinctively how things work. We're going to focus on what happens when you change the angle of your shock relative to the chassis and the axle. This can be used to set your axle height and change the shock tune. It's best not to do both adjustments at once. You really want to change as few variables as possible at a time. If you are changing the shock position horizontally or vertically, you are changing both the shock tune and the axle height at the same time. Don't do that. First, set your axle height by only moving the mounting location in line with the shock. Once you're happy with that, then only swing the shock in an arc like this to isolate the shock tune without changing ride height and axle height. When you change the angle of the shock, 4 shock tuning parameters change simultaneously. That can't be helped, but it can be managed if you know how. Let's break it down. The key variables that change are spring force, damping force, which equates to compression and rebound speed, wheel travel, and progression. Let's do a little bit of housekeeping to make sure we're all on the same page. This is the shock angle I will be referring to on an RC crawler, but it's generally true for any sliding shock swing arm suspension design, from F1 to moto to mountain bikes. When I'm showing the shock vertical, I mean to say that it's perpendicular to your linkage. A trailing arm design would look like this. If the trailing arms are not horizontal, it would look like this. For a 4-bar crawler linkage design, just split the difference between the links to get you started. Okay, let's get into it. First of all, spring force. When your shock and spring are perpendicular to your suspension, or basically vertical, in that orientation it has the maximum impact. That means as the wheel moves up and down, it pushes 1-to-1 or 100% against the spring. So your spring force is 100% effective. As you start to lay down the shock, your spring force becomes less and less effective. Standing it up, of course, makes it stiffer. It's the opposite. Now, here's a way to remember that. Imagine your shock vertical is 100%. Well, when you lay your spring all the way down horizontal and your wheel is moving up and down, it's not pushing against the spring at all. So at horizontal, there's no reaction on the spring. Vertical, there's 100% resistance from the spring. 100%. 0%, 100%, 0%. That means somewhere in the middle is in between 100 and 0. So as you lay it down and approach 0, your spring gets softer and softer and softer until it eventually is 0. Now, if you have to lay your shock down, but you don't want to soften your spring, there's what I call a parallel tuning method that can correct or affect your spring rate. So you can lay your shock down without getting your spring softer. The way you do that is by changing the spring altogether to a heavier or a lighter spring rate. Let's say, for example, you want a faster damping rate, So you lay your shock down, but you don't want a softer spring rate. You can change your springs to a heavier rate. Simple as that. Second off is your damping force. Now, damping is a force which translates into the speed of your wheel movement. It's a speed-based force, so as the shaft speed goes up, the force increases as well. It's not really a concern for slow-moving crawlers, but that's the intent of shocks, is they perform differently at different speeds. Similar to spring force, your damping force is at maximum impact when the shock is vertical, or 90 degrees from your swing arm. As you lay it down, that damping force starts to diminish, and your damping speed will increase. Standing it up, again, is just the opposite of that. Here's how to remember. It's the same way as spring rate. Vertical is 100%. If the shock is completely flat, then there's no way it can impart any force on the wheel. So this is zero. 100%, zero. In the middle is somewhere in between. So as you approach zero, your wheel speed goes up. Now, the parallel tuning method for damping is to change the oil weight. Let's say you want a softer spring response, so you lay the shock down, but you were happy with the damping speed. You can increase the oil weight to regain any losses from laying the shock down. The third point, and this is probably the most important one, is wheel travel. As you lay your shock down, your wheel travel increases. You want to be careful laying your shock down because you will be adding wheel travel and articulation that you might not want. Let's say you lay the shock down for whatever reason, but now you have too much articulation. Your wheels crash into the body where they before they didn't, or your wheels drop too deeply into holes and get stuck. This could be from too much wheel travel. If you find that you have too much travel, you can add shock shaft spacers, travel limiters, or put on a shorter stroke shock altogether to maintain the wheel travel that you want. That's the parallel tuning method for wheel travel. Now, the fourth one is progression, and this one gets a little bit complicated, so it will be explained in another video. As you lay the shock down, your spring rate and shock response becomes more progressive. The quick explanation is that a progressive linkage design, you have a greater differential in force from the beginning of the stroke to the end of the stroke. Your reaction force at the wheel gets progressively firmer faster than just the spring rate itself. Your effective spring rate may be 0.1 Newton millimeters. That's just at the beginning of the shock stroke. At the end of the shock stroke and at the end of your wheel travel, if you have a progressive linkage, you might have 0.15 Newtons per millimeter at the end instead of 0.10. That would be a 50% increase in effective spring rate coming only from the shock angle and linkage geometry. Progression is a really powerful tuning tool in many disciplines like trophy trucks, mountain bikes, supercross. Not so much on slow moving crawlers, but it's worth understanding. What did we learn? Only change one thing at a time. When your shock is flatter, you get softer springs, which you can mitigate by changing springs, faster damping, which you can correct with heavier oil, more vertical wheel travel, which you can adjust with shock shaft spacers. Of course, the opposite of all this is true if you're standing your shock up. Also, you get more progression, but don't stress too much over that on an RC crawler. I will discuss it in another video. I hope that makes sense. Happy tuning, and remember, it's just a toy, so have fun.